The Bible is God speaking to me. I am what the Word of God says I am. I can do what the Word of God says I can do. I have what the Word of God says I possess. I am a believer, not a doubter. My mind is renewed with the Word. Therefore, I'm thinking those thoughts that please my Father. I'm walking by faith and not by sight. In Jesus' name, amen. Hallelujah and amen. I want you to turn your Bibles, please, to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12. We've been talking about the Holy Spirit, His person, work. And so we're going to be looking at how the Holy Spirit works. And sometimes people don't understand when you talk about the subject of the Holy Spirit, they tend to think, well, now we're going to talk about someone who's invisible, and plenty of people have different opinions about the Holy Spirit. And they're thinking, well, isn't the Holy Spirit's experience and interaction with us just far too personal for us to try to find out how He operates and what He does? Well, no, we're not supposed to consider Him so personal that we can't see how He's operated throughout the Scriptures. You see, how do you walk when you have knowledge of the Holy Spirit? You're going to walk like one who can cooperate with Him and get results with Him. Turning the Scriptures to 1 Corinthians chapter 12. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, beginning at verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. Now, I always refer to what the Greek says concerning this. The Greek reads it this way. Now concerning things pertaining to and of the Holy Ghost, I would not have you ignorant. Again, now concerning things pertaining to and of the Holy Ghost, I would not have you ignorant. Another word for ghost is the word spirit. So, now concerning things pertaining to and of the Holy Spirit, I would not have you ignorant. Now let's read on further. 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 1. Now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. Notice the word gifts is italicized. It was added by the translators in order to try to bring forth a clearer understanding. But when you read it without the word gifts, which is italicized, it would read, now concerning spiritual, brethren, I would not have you ignorant. The Greek reads, now concerning things pertaining to and of the Holy Spirit. Now, let's look at verse 2. You know that you were Gentiles carried away into these dumb idols, even as you were led. He's explaining that you were spiritually active before you became a Christian. You were just not led by the Spirit of God. You were being led by the spirit of the devil, doing stuff that the devil wanted done. So when people find themselves, and he was talking to these Corinthian believers, he's letting them know, you had an organized, patterned way of behaving outside of the will of God. Where did you get that organized, patterned, disciplined behavior outside of the will of God? In other words, doing those things that did not give God the glory. You got it from a spirit, but it wasn't the Holy Spirit. It was the devil wanting you to cooperate as a child of darkness, a child of disobedience, a non-citizen. You were not a citizen in the kingdom of God. You were a non-citizen. You were without hope, without God, aliens of the promises of God. You were estranged from the covenant of God. So we're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 12 because Paul wants to explain the operations of the Holy Spirit, and he's letting believers know, don't you take a general attitude like, well, the Holy Spirit Yeah, he's there. Yes, I will acknowledge him, but to know the details of how he works and to understand him when he's functioning in the earth realm, are we really supposed to know that? Or is it that we just thank God we have the Holy Spirit who's with us? You do have him with you, but he wants to use you in specific ways. And he has ways in which he specifically works. And you should be able to identify when he's working and doing the work of God in the earth realm through the believer. And you should not be shocked when you see the Holy Spirit doing what he does through the body of Christ. So we're looking at 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 3. Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord, but by the Holy Ghost. Now, Paul the Apostle, being led of the Spirit of God to write this unto us, is informing us, hey, when you find people cursing the Lord, they cannot possibly be speaking by the Spirit of the Lord. God will never curse himself. God will never curse Jesus because Jesus is God the Son. He is the Word of God manifested. Therefore, we who believe on the Lord and are encouraged to be sensitive to the Holy Spirit who is prompting us to speak, we should always be glorifying God, never cursing God. And when you find an individual who is cursing God, just know this. The Holy Spirit is not behind that. The Holy Spirit will never lead a person to curse God. Now, this is one of the reasons why we have in the commandments, you shall not use the name of the Lord your God in vain. Why? Because when a person uses the Lord's name in vain, they're not being prompted by the Holy Spirit to do that. They're listening to another spirit, and we don't want to be a participant in what the devil wants us to say. Therefore, Paul the Apostle, by the Spirit of the living God, said this in verse 3, wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God calleth Jesus accursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is the Lord, but by the Holy Ghost. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit, and there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. And that means that the Holy Spirit has free capability of working through all the members of the body of Christ individually, collectively, and the Holy Spirit wants to operate in the body of Christ in a seamless manner. What do you mean by seamless? Well, you have articles of clothing that have seams that are part of the garment fitting your body. And that means your clothes are able to fit because the different parts of the article of clothing have been sewn together and form a seam. And those seams contribute to the overall fitting of that garment on your body. So when we talk about the Holy Spirit in operation, he's doing that in a manner in which this individual that's being led of the Lord to do something by the Holy Spirit will be a capable, well-proportioned, well-blessing to those that are in the body of Christ. So when the Holy Spirit is doing something, it's going to be a blessing. It's not going to bring a curse to the body, but a blessing to the body. Now let's read on further. He goes on in verse 4. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. And there are differences of administrations, but the same Lord. And there are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit withal. That means when the Holy Spirit operates through various individuals or collectively in the body of Christ, he's doing it so that the entire body of Christ can be built up, profited thereby. Profited means you're going to be increased. You're going to have greater revelation, greater understanding, greater foundation upon which you can say, I have a right to believe the way I believe because I have so much documentation from the scriptures that it causes me to be really grounded on the stance that I'm taking in faith. As we read on further in 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 8, for to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom, to another the word of knowledge by the same Spirit, to another faith by the same Spirit, to another the gifts of healing by the same Spirit, to another the working of miracles, to another prophecy, to another discerning of spirits, to another divers kinds of tongues, to another the interpretation of tongues. But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man severally as he will. That means we're not talking about the Holy Spirit making you pray every time you feel the Spirit, then you're going to pray. He may not give you a feeling to pray, but as a disciplined Christian, as a disciple of the Lord, knowing that men ought to always pray and not faint, you don't have to have the Holy Ghost tell you to pray. You should be willing to pray simply because you want to pray, because you can exercise your will to pray. And if you don't feel like praying, you still can pray even if you don't feel like it. Now, we're told from the scriptures, the Holy Spirit, he moves in the body of Christ and through the body of Christ, and he, the Holy Spirit, can do it as he wills. That means if he wants to perform a miracle, then he can perform a miracle through that yielded vessel in the body of Christ, and the miracle will be accomplished. When it's taken place or when it's done, should the person be praised? No, God should be praised because the Holy Spirit is always going to direct people to our Heavenly Father, to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. And that's why when we were together last week, we saw the woman who had been bowed over and Jesus healed her by the leading of the Holy Ghost, that the people glorified God for what was done. Now, even though the people glorified God, we know that there were people that were upset or frustrated. Isn't it interesting that when the Holy Spirit is doing a work, it may cause some people to be angry because they can't control it, because even though they may not have their will for it to happen, the Holy Spirit's will is going to win out above their will, which for their case, they didn't want it to happen, but it still happened. And so that's what was going on with the disciples. When we read the book of Acts, we find all of these manifestations of the Spirit of God. We find the operations of the Spirit of God. We find that the gifts of the Spirit are in operation, where you have apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors, and teachers that are being acknowledged and brought up through the scriptures in the book of Acts. And these manifestations that are taking place, it's by the Spirit of God. The Holy Spirit, the third person of the Godhead, is the agent of the Godhead that's working in the earth realm today through the body of Christ. And we are members in particular. That means when I see a person being used of the Spirit of God, and it's scripturally, foundationally sound, and definitely addition or a profit to the body of Christ, I should be rejoicing, not jealous. I shouldn't try to compare myself with them. If that's what the Holy Spirit wanted to do in that person's life and manifest those gifts in the operation at that time, who am I to say, Holy Ghost, that person shouldn't have been healed? That would be the wrong thing to do. Or that person should not have been set free from demons. Excuse me? If the Holy Spirit is operating and you're led by the Spirit of God to speak and cast out demons, as you should, we're told to do what the Word of God declares in Mark chapter 16, that there are things that believers are told to do by the Lord. We're told in his name, cast out demons. We're told to lay hands upon the sick and they shall recover. Now, these are gifts. You can cast out demons by the name of Jesus, but you can also be led of the Spirit of God to say, pay attention. When this manifestation of the evil spirit takes place, I want you to cast it out. And he'll tell you when to do it and how to do it. I know that Paul, when he was in the city of Philippi, and there was a woman who was following him and his company around. Luke was the writer of the book of Acts. He was part of Paul's company. He was a person that was like a historian and a scribe. And therefore, Luke said, this woman followed us, referring to Paul and his company. And this did she many days, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, and they're going to tell you a way of salvation, is what it reads in the original Greek. A way of salvation, not the way of salvation, but a way. And Paul was grieved in the spirit, and the Bible says, this did she many days. And then one day, Paul, being grieved in the spirit, he turned around and the Holy Ghost told him, cast a demon out of that woman. And he did. He turned and said, in Jesus' name, come out of her. And that spirit came out of her and she couldn't tell fortunes anymore. And her masters, which were making money off of her fortune-telling abilities, they were angry and frustrated because she lost the ability to tell fortunes by the power of the devil. And my point being is this, Paul was led by the Holy Ghost when to cast that demon out because he was grieved by her following them for many days, trying to give herself off as a credible witness of the power they were working with in Christ. Now, we have several places in Scripture. I'm just going to, for this purpose tonight, talk about the work of the Holy Spirit. Let's just stay within the book of Acts, and then I may want to refer to some other type of examples, but we're going to stay mainly in the book of Acts. So let's look at Acts chapter 17. Turn over in your Bibles to Acts chapter 17. And we'll see here how the Apostle Paul, being led of the Spirit of God, was used in a great and wonderful way. Yes, we know that the Holy Spirit used him. Now, because the Holy Spirit used him, then we can say to God be the glory for Paul the Apostle being led of the Spirit of God to do that which was right and good. I told you to turn to the book of Acts, chapter 17. Let's look at this. Verse 1. Now, when they had passed through Amphipolis and Apollonia, they came to Thessalonica, where was a synagogue of the Jews. And Paul, as his manner was, went in unto them and 3 Sabbath days reasoned with them out of the Scriptures. One of the things that we want to pay attention to is that the Holy Spirit will always lead you into the Scriptures. I'll say that again. The Holy Spirit will always lead you and direct you into the Scriptures. Why? Because the Spirit of God moved upon people to write the Scriptures as they were led by him so that we can have a documentation of how God wants things done and to be able to verify if it was God or not. Verse 3 of Acts chapter 17. Opening and alleging that Christ must needs have suffered and risen again from the dead, and that this Jesus whom I preach unto you is Christ. Now, underline the words is Christ. Because when we see is Christ, that's referring to Jesus is the anointed one. The Scriptures lets us know that he had the Spirit of God on him or upon him without measure. That means Jesus did what he did without limitation by the Holy Ghost using him simply because he spoke the words of God only. He did not seek after his own glory. Jesus only wanted to do those things that pleased the Father. And when he spoke those things that the Father told him to say, and he spake in such a way that the Holy Ghost told him what to speak. We're looking at Acts chapter 17. Verse 4 now. And some of them believed and consorted with Paul and Silas, and of the devout Greeks a great multitude, and of the chief women not a few. But the Jews which believed not, moved with envy. Now I want you to stop and look at this. When the Holy Ghost is using you or using those that are in the body of Christ in a manner in which God is receiving the glory, there may be those that are showing that they're envious, angry, and mad. The last time we were together, we were talking about how that the leader of the synagogue was mad at a woman who got supernaturally healed when the gifts of healings was in operation, and Jesus commanded her to stand up straight. He laid his hands upon her, and the woman was loosed from her infirmity. How a person can get mad at that? To me, it's like way, way, way out there. How can you get angry when a person is healed? But remember, we're not wrestling against flesh and blood. We're wrestling against the spiritual wickedness of in high and heavenly places, against the devil and his operation. I want you to keep your finger here. And I'll just read to you what Ephesians chapter 6 says. Ephesians 6:10, and we're going to look at Acts chapter 17. But I'm going to read to you what Ephesians 6:10 says. Ephesians chapter 6, verse 10, and we're going to go right back to Acts 17. Ephesians 6, verse 10. Finally, my brethren, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. That word wiles means strategies, his intentional plans to hurt you. Verse 12. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities, against powers, against the rulers of the darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places. Now, Paul is explaining, our warfare is not with flesh and blood and man. Our warfare is against the forces of darkness, against the devil and evil spirits. Wouldn't it then be wise for us to listen to the Holy Spirit to help us to win at every hand when the enemy, the devil, is trying to defeat us at every hand? My encouragement is, I would not have you ignorant concerning things pertaining to and of the Holy Ghost. It's necessary that you learn to flow in obedience to the Spirit of God, that you learn how to recognize when the Holy Spirit is doing a work, that you learn how to listen from your heart, being led into the Scriptures rather than your head, which may have been traditionally taught or been religiously taught or just may have been negatively influenced by all kinds of seducing information that didn't line up with the Word of God. My point being is this, as believers in Christ Jesus, I want you to be well informed about the Holy Spirit, his person and works. Now, Paul the Apostle then, having written what we saw in Ephesians chapter 6, he talks about we're not wrestling against flesh and blood. Then Paul is going to be aware of and start talking about the spiritual things that are going on, because the spiritual things are the things that God wants us to pay attention to so that we can walk spiritually in victory and stop being, as it were, victims of the strategies, the wiles, the plots and plans of the enemy to take you down. If you know the enemy is trying to take you down, wouldn't you want to listen to the Holy Ghost and let him show you how to walk in your day, how to be led of the Holy Ghost to apply the Scriptures to get results? Did you know when Jesus spoke to that fig tree and he said, no man shall eat fruit of thee hereafter forever, that he was led of the Spirit of God to do that? And that he, Jesus, when the results took place, Jesus was not shocked by the results. He told his disciples, you have the faith of God. That means I want you to be in position of the faith that God has for you. And if you operate in the God kind of faith, then you'll do exactly what I did. And what was it that you did, Jesus? Jesus spoke to the fig tree in Mark, that the 11th chapter, and the fig tree died because he cursed it. It's so necessary that all believers should be spiritually well-informed and mature in the understanding of how God wants us to walk in the light of the Word, listening to the Holy Spirit. Now, we're going to read again more in the book of Acts, 17th chapter. And we'll see here in Acts chapter 17 that in verse 5, but the Jews, which believed not, moved with envy, took unto them certain lewd fellows of the baser sort, and gathered a company, and set all the city on an uproar, and assaulted the house of Jason, and sought to bring them out to the people. And when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, crying, these have turned the world upside down, are come hither also. Now here's what's going on. The people that opposed Paul and what he was doing by listening to the Holy Ghost, they were concerned that the status quo would be upset, that there would be no longer the same practice of business as usual, that Jesus Christ and his kingdom was going to overthrow and turn up, as it were, turn up that which was oppressed, to bring up the oppressed and make them free people. And those that were the oppressors, by listening to the devil, would be put down because the kingdom of God was at hand. And what I'm saying unto you, there are plenty of people that are in places of high government that are afraid that those who believe on the Lord are going to awaken unto righteousness and sin not, and have some real statements to make of faith concerning what is right versus what is wrong. I'm so glad that we're taught from the Word of God to come out of obscurity and to stand forth as children of the light. You are the light of the world. You are the salt of the earth. And therefore, be led of the Holy Ghost and speak as he declares you should speak, and be used of him. Remember the manifestations of the Spirit? We had three that say something: prophecy, diverse kinds of tongues, with, I call it, the companion gift of interpretation of tongues. And then we have three gifts that reveal something: word of knowledge, the word of wisdom, discerning of spirits. And then we have the three that do something. I call them power gifts: special faith, working of miracles, and gifts of healings. All of these manifestations of the Spirit are given for the benefit of the body of Christ. And that's why when we look at the book of Acts, and you'll see also in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, you'll see these manifestations of the gifts. But under the Old Testament, there were two that were missing out of the nine, and that is diverse kinds of tongues with the companion gift of interpretation of tongues. But all the other gifts operated. Now, we're looking at the book of Acts, and we're seeing the manifestations of the gifts of the Spirit, how he works and works with us. Let's look at Acts chapter 17 here, and it says in verse 6, and when they found them not, they drew Jason and certain brethren unto the rulers of the city, crying, these that have turned the world upside down are come hither also, whom Jason hath received, and these all do contrary to the decrees of Caesar, saying that there is another king, one Jesus. And they troubled the people and the rulers of the city when they heard these things. Do you see how the devil is saying, don't call Jesus the king of your life. Don't call Jesus the king who's going to run the city, who's going to run the state, who's going to run the nations, who's going to run the world. Don't let Jesus, that's what the devil is telling people, don't let Jesus be identified as the king of the whole world. Why? Because the devil knows his days are up. The Bible says to the believers, let the devil have no place. Don't you let him have eye water to cry with? Don't you let the devil have a pebble? Don't you let him have a grain of sand? Don't you let the devil have an acre of land? Don't you let the devil have anything? Why? Because as that old rule of thumb is, if you give him an inch, he'll try to take a mile. The devil is not welcome here. He is an intruder. He is an arch enemy of God. And he hates the children of God. And this is the reason why you see the opposition as Paul was there preaching the word, why the individual, Jason, these people that opposed Paul, not Jason, but the other person that was bringing opposition against him, he was trying to get the people in the uproar in the city because he's like, man, these guys are preaching Jesus. He's trying to change our state. He's trying to change the way we handle finances and the way we oppress people. Now, verse 9 of Acts chapter 17. And when they had taken security of Jason and of the other, they let them go. And the brethren immediately sent away Paul and Silas by night unto Berea, whom coming thither went into the synagogue of the Jews. These were more noble than those in Thessalonica. And we have the book of Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. So it's explaining here how Paul ended up going to Thessalonica and how we have the letters of Thessalonians, 1st and 2nd Thessalonians. Verse 11 now of Acts chapter 17. And these were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they had received the word with all readiness of mind, and searched the scriptures daily whether those things were so. Now notice, Paul was in Berea, and the Berean believers were saying, man, we're going to take what you're saying, Paul, and we're going to compare what you're saying with the scriptures. Because if you're really talking from God, God cannot violate his word. And we know that the Holy Spirit moved upon individuals to write the word as they were led by him. And therefore, we're going to search the scriptures daily to see what you're telling us to do and informing us about God and the kingdom of God and about our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Why? Because the Holy Spirit will always confirm the word with signs following, and the word is written. Isn't that a great thing to know? That the people in Berea searched the scriptures daily to make sure that what they were being taught was actually so. I encourage people, listen to the Holy Spirit. He will confirm the word with more scripture that is already here. And he will show you how to compare scripture with scripture, because the Holy Spirit is the spirit of truth, and he will teach you, because that's what he does. He's a teacher. All right, verse 12. It says here, let's look at verse 11 again. First, verse 11 again of Acts chapter 17. And these were more noble than those in Thessalonica, in that they received the word with all readiness of mind and searched the scriptures daily, whether those things were so. Therefore, many of them believed also, and of the honorable women which were Greeks, and of men not a few. But when the Jews of Thessalonica had knowledge that the word of God was preached of Paul at Berea, they came thither also and stirred up the people. And then immediately the brethren sent away Paul to go, as it were, to the sea. But Silas and Timotheus abode there still. And they that conducted Paul brought him unto Athens. And receiving a commandment unto Silas and Timotheus for to come to him with all speed, they departed. Acts chapter 17, verse 16 now. Now, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly or completely given over to idolatry. So remember what we talked about? The Holy Ghost is going to talk to your spirit. He's going to bear witness of the scriptures in your spirit. As believers in Christ Jesus, you should be already excited that because you're new creatures in Christ, because you're born again, because you're alive unto God spiritually, the Spirit of God will bear witness with your spirit that the Spirit of God is dwelling in you and wants to do a work through you. So Paul was aware. He was looking at Athens, Greece, like God would have him to see it through his eyes. And Paul saw all of these things going on in Athens, Greece. He saw all of these idols. He saw people that were extremely devoted to spiritual things, but their spiritual devotion was a superstition. They were committed. They were dedicated. They were doing things in an organized fashion. But all of it was being done by the leading of the devil and not by God. The Holy Ghost will never lead you to bow down to an idol, O Christian. The Holy Ghost will never lead a non-believer to bow down to an idol. The Holy Ghost will always lead people to Jesus, because that's what he does. Keep your finger here in Acts chapter 17, and I'm going to read John's Gospel chapter 16. Because in John's Gospel, the 16th chapter, Jesus is speaking, and he said in verse 7, we're going to come back to Acts 17, but John's Gospel, the 16th chapter, verse 7 says, "Nevertheless, I tell you the truth." This is Jesus speaking. "It is expedient," which means profitable for you, "that I go away. For if I go not away, the Comforter will not come unto you, but if I depart, I will send him unto you." The Comforter is referring to the Holy Spirit. Verse 8, "And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin and of judgment," "and of righteousness and of judgment." Verse 8 again, John's Gospel, the 16th chapter, verse 8. "And when he is come, he will reprove the world of sin and of righteousness and of judgment. Of sin, because they believe not on me. Of righteousness, because I go to my Father and you see me no more. Of judgment, because the prince of this world is judged. I have yet many things to say unto you, but you cannot bear them now. Howbeit, when he," the Spirit of Truth, which is another name for the Holy Ghost, "when the Spirit of Truth is come, he will guide you into all truth. For he shall not speak of himself." That means he's not going to speak independently of the Father and of the Son. The Holy Spirit will speak in concert with the will of the Father, the will of the Son, and he, the Holy Spirit, will speak to help you understand the Father and the Son, and you'll be able to say, "I got it." Verse 13 of John's Gospel, 16th chapter. "Howbeit, when he, the Spirit of Truth, is come, he will guide you into all truth, for he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, that shall he speak. He will show you things to come." Verse 14 of John's Gospel. Now, chapter 16 of John's Gospel, verse 14. "He shall glorify me, for he shall receive of mine and shall show it unto you." Now, when it says he will glorify me, that means the Holy Ghost will always direct people to Jesus. The Holy Ghost will not lead people to idols. He's not going to lead people to glorify man, as if to say, "Man, you are great and you speak and you are the best thing, and get your attention off of God and on man." No, the Holy Ghost will always lead you to Jesus. And this is the reason why it's so important for every believer to understand even the manifestations of the Spirit. They will always lead you to dwell on Jesus, the resurrected Lord. Turn back to Acts chapter 17 now. Now, verse 16, Acts 17, verse 16. "Now, while Paul waited for them at Athens, his spirit was stirred in him when he saw the city wholly given to idolatry. Therefore disputed he in the synagogue with the Jews and with the devout persons and in the market daily with them that met with him." So Paul said, "I can't keep quiet about what I know. I know things by the Holy Ghost showing me through the scriptures." So instead of me just keeping my mouth quiet and walking around and tolerating those who are following after evil impulses from the devil and following after demons, he said, "I got to talk with y'all and reason with you." Look at verse 18, Acts chapter 17, verse 18. "Then certain philosophers of the Epicureans and of the Stoics encountered him. And some said, 'What will this babbler say? others some, he seemeth to be a setter forth of strange gods, because he preacheth unto them Jesus and the resurrection. Notice that. Paul, being led of the Holy Ghost, preached Jesus and the resurrection. Verse 19, and they took him and brought him unto Areopagus, saying, may we know what this new doctrine whereof thou speakest is? For thou bringest certain strange things to our ears. We would know therefore what these things mean. For all the Athenians and strangers which were there spent their time in nothing else but either to tell or to hear some new thing. Then Paul stood in the midst of Mars Hill and said, you men of Athens, I perceive that in all things you are too superstitious. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, verse 23 again. For as I passed by and beheld your devotions, I found an altar with this inscription, to the unknown God, whom therefore you ignorantly worship, him declare I unto you. Meaning, the unknown God that you put on this idol that you don't even know what to worship based upon your statement to the unknown God this is devoted to. I'm going to tell you about the unknown God. And the unknown God is not an idol. Listen to verse 24. Of Acts chapter 17. God that made the world and all things therein, seeing that he is Lord of heaven and earth, dwelleth not in temples made with hands, neither is worshipped with men's hands, as though he needeth anything, seeing he giveth to all life and breath and all things, and hath made of one blood all nations of men to dwell on all the face of the earth, and hath determined the times before appointed the bounds of their habitation, that they should seek the Lord, if happily they feel after him, and find him, though he be not far from every one of us. For in him we live and move and have our being, as certain also of your own poets have said, for we are also his offspring. For as much then as we are the offspring of God, we ought not to think that the Godhead is like unto gold or silver or stone graven by art and man's device, and the times of this ignorant God winked at, but now commanded all men everywhere to repent. Now what we're saying is, the world at one point in time said, we're going to ask you, where is your God? And when the people who said, is in heaven, the people of the world said, well, we can show you our God by the idols that they made. And then when Jesus came on the scene, Jesus appeared on the scene, he was a virgin, and the Word came from eternity and became encased in mortal flesh. Jesus was God in the flesh, the Christ, Emmanuel. And so now the attention was being pointed at Jesus. Our God is him right there who walks in the flesh. And they crucified him. He rose from the dead. He's alive from the dead. And our God now is invisible. And the world is saying, well, you know, we think that you still ought to worship idols. Well, we're not worshiping idols. Our God stepped out of eternity into time and took upon himself our sins, our sicknesses, our diseases, our poverty, our mental anguish, our confusion. He took it upon himself and gave us eternal life. Now, my encouragement is, if you want to receive freedom and benefits and blessings, listen to what the Holy Ghost is doing. He's directing everybody's heart to pay attention to the fact that Jesus is really who he says he is. He's the Christ, the resurrected Lord, the giver of eternal life. Now, as we continue to look at these scriptures in the book of Acts, my encouragement is read from the first chapter all the way to the end of the book of Acts. And when you see the gifts of the Spirit in manifestation, then I want you to see that the Holy Spirit is moving through, operating through individuals that know the Lord to help people to come to Christ, a real relationship with the living God. I love you, and I thank God for your paying attention to these wonderful messages. We're getting a chance to see the Holy Ghost work. And you can also see the Holy Ghost work in the books of Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, and from Genesis to Revelation. But we're just going to look at the book of Acts right now. Salvation is the free gift that the Lord offers anyone who would believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. The Bible says in Romans 10:9-10 that with our hearts we believe unto righteousness, and with our mouth confession is made unto salvation. I trust that you will believe God's word, that your faith will be in the risen Savior who came to give his life for you. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Will you pray with me this prayer of salvation? It's not difficult. It's very easy. But you must mean it from your heart. So repeat these words after me. Jesus, I confess you as my Savior and my Lord. I believe in my heart that God raised you from the dead. With my mouth, I confess you and I receive you as my Savior. Jesus, thank you for making my heart your home. Thank you for living in me. God the Father is now my Father, and the Holy Spirit has done a work in me. I am a new creature in Christ Jesus, my Lord. Thank you, Lord, for saving me, and thank you for guiding my life. In Jesus' name, amen. We're here to be a blessing to you at Spirit Food Christian Center. The way this broadcast is brought to you is by people's faithful sowing and reaping as a result of God's word being given unto them. So I want to encourage you, be a part of this ministry of sowing and reaping. The Bible says, whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap. In this ministry, we believe that man must hear the word of God. For man does not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceedeth out of the mouth of God. The Bible declares, God is able to make all grace abound toward you, that you always have all sufficiency in all things, may abound to every good work. God loves a cheerful and hilarious giver. I encourage you, be a part of this ministry. Be hilarious in your giving and watch the Lord bring it back to you in many, many ways. In Jesus' name.
You have been watching the Spirit Food Christian Center Worldwide Webcast online at www.myspiritfood.com. Join us for worship service each Sunday at 9:30 a.m. And be sure to check out our website for our weekly live broadcast and much, much more. Taste and see that the Lord is good.